Robert says, "Hey coaches, thanks a million for the insightful podcast. Does training or general activity expedite caffeine metabolism? In other words, does caffeine get processed quicker when in an active state? Thank you very much." So this is like this is kind of the bro science thing, right, Nate, of where it's like we were talking about this before, where it's kind of like run it through your system, or like
yeah, it's when you're drinking alcohol, they say like, oh, just have a cup of coffee or have some Waffle House, it'll like you'll process it faster, which does not happen, everyone. Like that doesn't happen, but people think
just,
it does, right?
It's just pummeling yourself. It's like Waffle House, like hungover Waffle House is just pummeling yourself down deeper. So
do this thing to sober up when really it's just time based to be for your body to process it.
Drink a bunch of water. All these things, I mean, they do help you feel better in other ways, but they're not achieving what you think you're achieving.
Waffle House does make you feel better in some ways, I guess.
But you're drunk, so you don't know.
So Chad, where do we want to, caffeine in general, and where do we want to jump in with this?
So it's a super short answer. I do have a bunch of information afterwards that's just on caffeine in general, which I think will be interesting and useful. Short answer, no. It's fat soluble. So it's not just as though it's circulating in your bloodstream. And if you amp up your circulation, you're going to push more of the muscle and you're going to utilize more of it and it's going to clear faster. That's not how it works. It's metabolizing the liver, and exercise doesn't speed up your liver processes. So no.
Sadly. Let me tie this into cycling really quick for some context for somebody. That means that if you were to take 200 milligrams of caffeine in a sedentary state versus 200 milligrams of caffeine in an active state, it doesn't mean that when you're riding your bike, you're going to utilize it faster or process it faster, run through it faster.
Yeah. Your blood is not the rate limiting aspect of this. It's enzymes in the liver. I'll talk about those now.
Cool. Awesome. All right. Explicitly stated. Okay. Now let's get into the details.
Yes. So this is what I feel to be more interesting information and perhaps actually useful. And it is based on research. There's a lot of bro science out there and a lot of sources to find it. I went to, I don't want to say the name of the website, but it was a coffee producer's website. Man, do they have the answers. Not a single one of them was based on science or research or evidence.
Not surprising.
Okay, so what we do know and what we've talked about before is that the effects are relative to your body weight. We try to scale caffeine intake relative to your weight, you know, milligrams per kilogram of body weight. And what we've found, what research has supported and shown time and again, is that somewhere within the 3 milligrams per kilogram of body weight up to 6 milligrams per is the most effective range. Veering toward the higher side of that when you need to affect performance, endurance performance in our cases. Going beyond that doesn't carry any further benefit, and it predisposes or sets you up for probably the issues that come with overconsumption of caffeine. And they're rather unpleasant when you push the higher bounds. Mm-hmm. So caffeine is metabolized at different rates. This is another thing that has been shown, and this is time and again, and this is largely genetically determined. I think like 73% or so of the variability in caffeine response is tied to genetics. In particular, it's the rate at which you metabolize or clear caffeine from your blood. And this is tied to one particular enzyme in the cytochrome P450 family, which is a family of liver enzymes that actually metabolizes a lot of different drugs. It does a lot of different things, but not least of which is metabolizes a number of drugs, caffeine being one of them. In particular, this is the polymorphic cytochrome P450-1A2. So just
want to sound super, of course.
Want to sound super smart there, which we call CYP1A2. So if you've ever heard that term bandied about, this is what we're talking about. It's really
every
how quickly.
Day. Oh God.
That will be on the test, everyone. So make sure when we have the final, we're going to have a Coach Chad final coming up.
We have talked about this enzyme before, and I just, so if it, you know, if your ears pricked up, it's like, it's kind of memorable. No, it's fine. Mm-hmm. This appears to be the rate limiter in terms of caffeine metabolism. And how it breaks down is if there are two different alleles of this, so two different gene variants. Your mom gives you one, your dad gives you the other. If you're homozygous, meaning you got the A from both of them, you're a fast metabolizer. If you have the variant, the AC variant, meaning one gave you a C, one gave you an A, you're a slow metabolizer. And also, for whatever reason, you can be homozygous for the Z and still be slow. Now remember these because they'll factor in just a minute here. this largely explains why we see such a disparity or such a variance in caffeine's half-life. Seen studies that say it's 2 hours all the way up to 12 hours in particular individuals. These are more limited studies, smaller pool sizes. Typically, it seems to fall around 6 hours for half-life is what's pretty consistent across studies. And this kind of it makes you recognize that these caffeine cutoffs are pretty subjective, and they're not something where you can get super liberal with them. You can't say, you know, my cutoff is 12 noon, so I'm going to dose myself with 600 milligrams of caffeine and I'm a fast responder, so it's going to clear the system in time for me to get to bed. It still has a rather long half-life, and big dosages don't remove you from the impacts it's going to have on your sleep. So you have to do some self-experimentation, and anybody who drinks coffee has probably done this over time anyway, but you do have to recognize when the cutoff is so that it doesn't impact your sleep. Yeah. So to further this, back to those alleles or those combinations of genes that your parents bestow upon you. There was a study done by guests and colleagues back in 2018 where they had cyclists, high level, I think they said fit cyclists, do a 10 kilometer time trial. It was randomized, double blind, placebo controlled, all that. And they used dosages of 0, 2, and 4 milligrams of caffeine per kilogram. And what they found was, again, that AA gene allele or that AA gene version saw ergogenic effects at 2 mg/kg and 4. The AC variant didn't see any, and the CC, so homozygous, but on the C end of things, saw diminished endurance performance. Whoa. So not only can it affect how quickly it clears your bloodstream, but it can positively and negatively, depending on your gene variation, affect performance.
And so can I put that in another light then? Does that mean that some people might be not only non-responders, some people could be non-responders to caffeine and it could hurt their performance?
Mm-hmm. They could actually be hampering their performance capabilities.
Crazy.
Wild.
I know, right?
According to this study.
Huh. Crazy.
Yeah. Okay. So moving on. Nate brought this up and I thought it's an interesting point too. It's still on the caffeine topic, but there are some synergists that affect how caffeine affects you, whether or not you're a fast metabolizer, slow metabolizer, doesn't seem to be a concern. So there's something called L-theanine, which is a non-proteinogenic amino acid. So you know, it has analogs that do produce proteins. This is not one of them. The effects of L-theanine, I'm going to go with theanine over theanine, you choose which you prefer, are complementary to caffeine's negative effects. So the anxiety and the jitteriness and the overstimulation that a lot of people get with caffeine, especially when they dose it too highly, can be countered with a dosage of L-theanine. It's typically along the lines of 100 to 200 milligrams. And this has been touted as improving cognitive function and mood. Both things caffeine do, but it does it without the negative impacts of caffeine. So effectively it's relaxation without sedation. You know, you don't get tired. You just chill out. And it's also shown the ability to attenuate caffeine-related sleep disturbances. So some studies do support that this can help you, you know, it has positive impacts on sleep, especially if the caffeine has revved you up to a point where you need something to counter it. Now, there is a possible point of confusion with L-theanine, and then that's theacrine. I'm going to go with theacrine. And it's similar to caffeine because it's an adenosine receptor. So we talked about over the course of the day, your synapses build up an accumulation of adenosine. And this is what creates sleep pressure. We basically circumvent that, push caffeine to these same receptors, block the adenosine. Well, this theacrine does the same thing. Hmm. And fortunately, it doesn't appear to lead to tolerance like caffeine does. It may eventually, but it doesn't do it as rapidly. And caffeine, actually, if you were to combine the two, caffeine enhances the bioavailability of theacrine. Not vice versa, but who cares? Because caffeine is like 99% absorbed within the first 45 minutes. It's highly bioavailable. Mm-hmm. The theacrine takes longer to peak, and it also takes longer to fade. It has a much longer half-life. Of course, this is dose-dependent, but somewhere in the ballpark of 16 to 22 hours. So this does mean that you have to time your dosage much more carefully, early morning might be a great way to go because then it, you know, sustains you all day. Maybe in the case of ultra endurance events, this could be a good solution to staying alert and cognitively aware. But if this is interesting to you, I only touched on this, so definitely do your homework because some of this research is probably a little outdated, but probably still pretty accurate.
So I guess going into caffeine in general, Nate, I don't know if we talked about this when we were at Valley of the Sun stage race, but this is one thing, and you pointed this out too, Amber. When you take caffeine or any sort of substance like this, right? Like you have to be careful because of the sleep effects. And yeah. Especially if you have like, you're in the middle of a big training block or you're in the middle of a race, like a stage race, something like that, it can have pronounced effects. Did you notice that like people reducing caffeine intake during stage races at all ever? Or did you do that personally, Amber?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there's, you know, with most of the fueling products on the market, you always have a version that includes caffeine these days. Mm-hmm. And we would have to be really careful about that. So a lot of the racing I did was stage racing. So there's definitely an ergogenic effect. I'm a fast metabolizer. It 100% helps me. I love my cup of coffee in the morning. I love having a shot of espresso before a crit, but we would have to be really careful during stage races. If the crit was in the afternoon, I wouldn't do that because the ergogenic effect of the crit wasn't enough to outweigh the loss of sleep and then feeling terrible the next morning for the next 80 mile stage. So there's definitely a positive effect. I know a lot of athletes that love their coffee, but yeah, for sure. Even at the pro level, you would have to be really careful about when you're taking it and whether you're taking a caffeinated gel or non-caffeinated gel during the race, because you're thinking not only about the race today, but what's coming the next day.
Nate was like rattling his bones were rattling at Valley of the Sun.
I made a new mistake. So you know in the Wolf of Wall Street when like they take like the lewds and they're kind of old, so they're like time release, so they take some more, then they take another one and they all hit it once.
I really like this lead in.
So, this is going great.
I like the use of lewds.
I don't know what the real like name is. I just seen the movie.
Quaaludes.
Is that what it is? Yeah. I had some older caffeine pills, like probably good 2 years old. And in my experience, I don't know if this is for real or not, but the older they are, they have a little bit of like a time release. So when I took them an hour before the TT, which is normally a pretty good time for me to take them, I did not feel them during the TT, but about, our TT was like 11, but about 3 or 4 PM. Oh my. Like I all the caffeine came into my body and we were sitting on the couch and I'm like, let's go, let's do this podcast. I was ready to go. And
imagine a motorcycle with like the throttle stuck wide open and it's just spinning.
In first gear. So that was probably not ideal. And that night was hard to sleep and I had some L-theanine with me and tried to take that, but just be aware if you get older caffeine that there could be a time relay. And I don't know if that's true. This could all be in my head, but yeah, that's bad.
Something worth saying is that caffeine in and of itself is not necessarily a very controlled substance in terms of like production and everything else. So you can go online and you can look at the different like Global Dro and that sort of stuff. And then I can't remember the name of the resources, but two episodes ago, we talked about some resources where you can like download an app, basically. It's like the Safe for Sport or something like that, I believe is the name. And you can look at different brands that have basically followed some sort of testing protocol with whether it's their assembly line or the product or something else. But it's deemed as being something that would be safe for an athlete to consume if they have to worry about anti-doping things with like cross-contamination and such.
This is a good thing to say too, is never use caffeine powder because you could be confused in dosing with grams and milligrams, something like that. And too much caffeine is fatal. So don't go above that 6. I mean, I would try 3 milligrams per kilogram of body weight and see how that is. Definitely, I wouldn't go above 6.
Yeah, right. You have to go extremely high for it to be fatal though.
Yeah, but yeah, there's cases where I just want to say this because it's important. It's the powder that'll get you because they'll get the wrong unit. And then that's when you're like, oh, this is like protein powder, right? When it should not be like protein powder.
Oh, gosh, no.
Don't do that, no.
But you could see how someone could get confused by that, right?
Yeah, like, totally right.
So with the pills, it's hard because you're like, should I really be taking 28 pills? Like, that doesn't sound right.
Yeah. Well, exactly. Isn't it the case, Chad, that, I mean, caffeine, there's like a U-shaped curve, right? So you with increasing dosage, you get more and more of a positive effect. And then there is a point at which you have diminishing returns. Yeah. So if you actually take too much, you know, in that zone before it's fatal, that you're actually, it's counteractive. It's not.
Yeah, that's why. That's why that 3 to 6 range, 6 being the upper limit, is pretty agreed upon. I mean, very, very agreed upon. And credit where credit's due. I pulled from a few resources, but I leaned heavily on Stronger by Science. I think it was Greg Knuckles did this one, but his breakdown on caffeine intake, and I think it even has a couple links to related stuff that he's done. It's comprehensive. It's an extremely good resource.
I think all of us agree that caffeine is definitely performance enhancing, and we can just you know, speak individually, but then the science also backs that up. Absolutely. I've noticed that it feels like it lowers RPE, makes it easier to be able to focus, like things like time trials, things like, you know, anything where a lot of focus is required. I think that it's absolutely a performance enhancing but legal substance to be able to take in.
Here's the most proof for me is it used to be banned in the Olympics at a high percentage in your blood. Like anything that gets banned works, right? And so it was used to be banned. I don't know why they unbanned it, but that should be proof enough.
Yep. And it's also worth saying that it absolutely can be an addictive substance, and it's not something that you should take if you have any sort of concerns with that or health issues. Talk to your doctor before you take this sort of stuff for sure. All of those sort of disclaimers definitely need to be in place, because this isn't like this isn't something that we're not discounting the fact that it can become, you know, dependencies can develop and it can be dangerous for sure.
But caffeine overdose is real and it's highly unpleasant. We've been faced with it, and I'm sure everyone's had a bit too much caffeine from time to time, and it's unpleasant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And for a person that hardly ever takes in caffeine, and then, you know, during, you know, key races, that sort of stuff, I take it in, that 3 milligrams per kilogram, I am flying. Like if I take any more, I'm afraid I'd break apart. So like it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to take a bunch. So hopefully that covers it there on that. Do you want to add anything, Amber?
I was just going to say, I think in a previous episode we talked about, I went through an experiment once where I was trying to like cut out caffeine for a while so that I was decreasing my tolerance, so that when I actually had some at a race, it was much more of a higher effect. And what I found was, I mean, it worked. I had a much, much more salient effect at the race, but at what cost? the cost was that on my daily training sessions, suffered enormously because I didn't feel myself. And part of that was the caffeine withdrawal. But also some of that was just, I felt like I was leaving something on the table in every single training session. And I felt like I would gain more from, you know, maximizing the quality of every training session than I was by getting an extra bump on race day.
Yep. And that's a super good point, because if it does lower RPE, but it doesn't lower it to such a rate that you're able to, like, you know, put yourself too far down into a hole, but if it lowers your RPE so that you can complete your workouts with more precision and do that sort of thing, then you're talking about something that is genuinely like very helpful.
Right. And as a caveat, I'm a fast metabolizer. This is how it affects me in particular, and it's different for everybody. So you have to figure out what works for you.
Yeah, I can practically smell the stuff and then I'm already going. So,
if you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.